So recently I played Silent Hill Downpour, and I even did a deep dive on the first issue of the comic book and story, and I ended up getting the rest of the comic books to go along with it. And I decided, why not just do a video where I fill in all the blanks of where the comic book story takes place. So first off, we have to explain that this story is about a inmate named Murphy Pendleton, and he is in prison. All that we know so far is that he has a dead son, and that he's very reminiscent of other Silent Hill characters in that way. A family member dead. Of course, we learn along the way that Pendleton is asked to kill somebody in the showers of the prison, and ultimately we think that this is him getting revenge for his son's death. But before any questions are answered, he's already being transferred out of the prison to another one, and this girl Anne, the guard, who's transferring with him, seems to have, for some reason, fixated on Murphy, and we do not know why. Of course, it's not long before they're in a crash, and they end up in Silent Hill. Of course, this is about the time when Pendleton wakes up from the crash. He goes searching around, he tries to escape, and he ends up running into Anne near a cliff face. And this is how the scene plays out.
That's far enough. Get your ass down on the ground now. Hands where I can see them. Do it.
Take it easy. I'm not going anywhere.
I said, on the ground now.
I was just looking for help.
And you just happened to lose your cuffs in the process? Save the bullshit.
This is stupid. I'll meet you back down at the bus, okay? You're gonna get yourself killed.
Shut up. Keep your goddamn hands where I can see them.
Wake up from this is we see that Anne has fallen into the abyss in the first issue of the comic book, and she is taken basically to nowhere. Where the town is transporting her around between its, you know, magical power, spooky dimensions, however Silent Hill works. And she's going deeper into the darkness of nowhere. And that's when she comes across her dad's security guard name tag, Coleridge. And she says, Daddy, and she remembers him saying, someday I'm gonna have a name button on my shirt just like that. Actually, she says that, sorry. But after finding that along the way, she runs into somebody who she thinks is Pendleton hacking away at somebody else. And it turns out that it was a Silent Hill monster impersonating Pendleton, who is her deepest, darkest, you know, ruler of this realm. And he was whacking at one of the other prisoners on the bus that crashed. Of course, he doesn't make it. and the town gets a hold of him and kills him. Shocked by this revelation of what's going on in front of her and all that's happening, Anne takes a couple of pot shots at the monster and notices a man saying, "Hey, you know, come this way." And she goes with him to escape. Now, he goes on this whole conversation about how hard life is and how much he's trying to been drinking away the pain. And we see this children on here on his little ride. And the train accident at Devil's Pit caused the death of 8 children. And she puts 2 and 2 together, realizing that it was him who had caused this accident. And he says that the town are liars, that that's not true. He doesn't want to cop up or admit to it. And he says, and she says, "Stop the train, get me off." And he says he would if the children would let him. And they morph and they turn into monsters. And there's this huge looming figure over there. And it basically comes after Anne and she blacks out. Now, upon waking up, Anne is having a flashback where she was lying in bed at home and one of the guardsmen from the prison comes and tells her, "Hey, you know, your dad, there's been an accident with him." And she wakes back up in Silent Hill after this, remembering this memory, and she has a renewed sense of why she's doing all this. Looks at her daddy's badge and says, "Oh yeah, that's right, I'm here for Pendleton." We pick back up where Pendleton left off, and he has run into a character known as the Mailman. Now, many fans have speculated that the Mailman is immortal, and that the town has made him immortal, keeping them there almost as a guide for its own needs. The Mailman tells Pendleton that he can take the SkyTram to get to his destination, so Pendleton, Murphy, decides to go and do that. Upon trying to fix the tram, Murphy runs into a red ball lit up with light that tries to chase and eradicate him. And after escaping and falling down some tunnels, he runs into our old friend the bus driver again. After a short conversation at Devil's Pit, JP tells him to take the caverns to get to where he needs to go. But after a short jaunt through the caverns, Pendleton runs into JP again, who basically commits suicide because he can't deal with the overwhelming fact that he did indeed kill those children at Devil's Pit. Of course, it's his guilt that pushes him over the edge, and him being in absolute denial about it. After Pendleton rides on the actually pretty cool like little train ride through the caverns and gets attacked, he finally runs into Anne again, and this is where we left her in issue 1 of the comic book, as clearly the town has been pushing her around to run into Pendleton. And the first 5 pages of the comic book actually play out this scene, so let's just go ahead and watch that, and then we'll revert to this page 6 of issue 2 afterwards.
Up against the wall.
You don't have to do this. We should help each other. This place, I don't know what it is or how we got here.
One thing I should... Just shut up. Where did you get this? Where in the hell did you get this?
I just found it in these clothes. I didn't...
Is this some kind of sick joke to you?
No, I swear. I don't know what's going on any more than you do.
on your knees.
What?
On your fucking knees. You heartless bastard. You don't deserve to live. You're not fit to walk this earth while good, decent men.
I don't know who you think I am or what you think I've done.
Shut the hell up! You think this is funny, don't you? Well, let's see how funny it is with a fucking bullet in your head. Waiting for. Leave me alone, God damn it!
Now, the reason that Anne stopped there is because she remembers that her father had told her, and she's having a flashback, that they're there to protect lives, not take them. And upon seeing what she thinks is her father in a wheelchair not far from her, she wonders who that is pushing him, and she gets into a fight with a Silent Hill nurse. Now, this next part is pretty tragic because Anne decides to try and talk the warden into getting Pendleton sent to where they are from the jail that he's in, a transfer. And the warden says that he knows that she's having marital problems, and the only reason he's going to do that for her, or the only way, is if she gives in to his demands, which happen to be very sexual. And this situation just really turns out to not work in Anne's favor. Of course, it's around this time when a Silent Hill monster appears, trying to remind her of the filthy, evil deed she did to get to this point in Silent Hill, chasing Pendleton. Now, there is a giant phallic scene here, but I cannot show it to you because of YouTube, obviously. But trust me when I say that it is indeed there. Regardless, Anne wakes up back outside on the roads of Silent Hill. And she immediately runs into the mailman, who tells her that there's a downpour coming, and that it's best to head into town after this guy he just met named Pendleton. And he says that he probably went to the radio station. You know, that big old building over there, the clock tower. Turn to Anne looking into a store at these monster figures.
Teach him he can trust me like a brother. One day we'll saddle up and ride. And we're gonna ride.
And she starts to rekindle the memory that she had of her wedding day and the vows she took with her husband, and her father was there. And we start to realize something right underneath it, that she did in fact sleep with the warden.
I'm gonna find me a reckless
she did all this so that she could get Murphy close to her so that she could kill him. Tragically, her husband finds out about it, and he decides to leave her. It's at this point that all the monsters that she was looking at, the mannequins in the window, come alive and they start to repeat the words that her husband said to her before he left. But having had enough of it, sick of it all, Anne decides to fight back. Now, it's around this point when we get a little glimpse into the fact that Anne has talked to the guard, Sewell, who we first saw with Murphy at the beginning of the game. Then, it cuts right back to her in Silent Hill, walking down the streets towards the clock tower. But on her way there, something very peculiar and odd happens. As she comes across a car with like a dead bull in it, and it falls out, and then she sees her dad in a wheelchair, and the end boss from the first game comes and stabs her through the back, out the chest, and it looks like she's going to die. But it turns out that's not the end for Anne, as she wakes up, somehow still alive, and she's inside the clock tower, hearing two voices coming from the radio room. Now, on Pendleton's side of things, we learn that he made a deal with Sewell. Sewell, the guard we saw at the beginning of the game, the guard that Anne was talking to about Murphy's transfer. And we learned that not only did he make a deal with Sewell, but Sewell requested that he do a favor for him in return. And during these revelations, that's when Murphy finally makes his way to the radio room. At just at the same moment that somehow Anne also found herself right outside the door. And much like in the comic book, the scenes plays out the same way as it does in the video game.
This, my brothers and sisters, was another rock and roll classic coming to you courtesy of DJ Ricks on this fine afternoon. Weatherman says there's a storm coming our way to spoil the fun. So batten down the hatches and snuggle up under the blanket with the one you love, because it's going to be a rough ride. And speaking of rough rides, we got another dedication going out to my man with the plan, Murphy Pendleton. Somebody out there has got an eye on you, MP, so watch your back and keep it on track. Hey, man, come on in. Got a disc spinning right now, so you ain't interrupting nothing. Man, you look like you just saw a ghost or something. You all right?
Not really, no.
Good to hear. So what can DJ Bobby Ricks do for you?
Murphy Pendleton?
Like I was saying, what can DJ Bobby Ricks do for you, Murphy? Got a track you want to play, or?
I'm the guy you've been putting out the dedications for. I got the message. I came to find you.
Afraid you got the wrong man, Murphy. I don't know what you're talking about. But if there's a song you want to hear or a dedication you want to make, I could. You're listening to the DJ Rick Show on WLMN-FM, where the tracks are tight and the sweet melodies flow on and on. It's always a perfect day with DJ Ricks, your on-air friend to the end.
Look, man, I came through hell and high water to get here because you called me. Now cut the bullshit, because I don't have time for this.
Chill out, man. If you don't keep your voice down, you're going to get us both in trouble. And you do not want that. You don't know who might be listening. You understand? Thank God someone finally heard me. I can't even tell you how long it's been, just spinning record after record after record, hoping someone.
What the hell's going on here, Ricks? What is this place?
Time to explain. If we're gonna get out of here, we gotta move fast. You getting this far tells me we might even have a chance of getting out alive.
What's the plan?
Ray, listen. I got this boat. She's moored down at the marina. She's fast, real fast. Problem is, some motherfucker ransacked the studio and checked the keys.
I'll hotwire it. No problem.
That's not gonna work. This place, it does strange shit to reality, man. It's like there's rules you gotta follow. You know what I mean?
Bobby Ricks?
Uh-huh. Yeah, sure. Who's it going out to? But I... That's nice of you to think of me. Yeah. Real nice. Thank you. They're coming.
Who?
Doesn't matter. We gotta find those keys. They're on the silver chain says freedom. You can't... Miss...
Pendleton.
Put the gun down, damn it. We might have a way out of here.
You. I need to use your phone.
Sorry, lady. Calls come in, but don't go out. Just because folks want to be heard, don't mean they're willing to listen. See for yourself.
What the hell's going on around here?
We're sorry, but this line is all dead. All dead, Annie.
No! So as we return to Murphy's story, most people might be surprised to find out that we're actually only halfway through the video game, even though we are on the final issue of the comic book. Murphy gets a letter from Howard the mailman and is told to go to the monastery where he is going to collect a dead relative. But in the end, this is really for him to go and get the keys to the boat to escape Silent Hill on the DJ's boat. And after witnessing some horrific things, Murphy eventually goes and runs into a little boy who tells him that he has to collect the rhyme to prove that he's not the boogeyman and he'll let him in through the door. Turns out that doesn't work out so well.
Leave him alone, damn it! No! The one with your skin splayed out from within. Once the monster has his fun, oh god! Darling! Take heed, it's not too late. His mistakes needn't haunt you forever. He's just a kid, you son of a bitch! Though you have regret, you can't just forget. You alone decide your fate.
So it turns out what happens was that Murphy's son, Charlie, had drowned, and he blamed the man he killed in the shower at the beginning of the game, his neighbor. That's the favor that Sewell did for him, is he set him up to kill the man that he blamed his son drowning on. And this whole thing comes full circle when Sewell finally asks him for a favor, and Murphy realizes that it's to kill another guardsman. in the prison during a riot, and it turns out that that guardsman is someone who trusts him named Coleridge. Coleridge, as in Anne's father. We learn that Murphy did not want to kill him and refused to do it. And that means that Sewell has to do it himself. But he ends up blaming Murphy for it, which leads Anne to think that he indeed did, in fact, kill her father. Now, Murphy has to confront the monster wearing the keys around its neck that would take him to the boat to escape Silent Hill. And the monster ends up kind of being himself because he realizes that even after he got revenge on the person who he blames for his son's drowning, that he found no solace in it and that he got nothing out of it. And that the whole thing, the whole point of it, was completely emotionally pointless to him. But ultimately, he has to fight and defeat his inner monster and at some point kill it. And afterwards, Pendleton finally has the keys to get on the boat and leave Silent Hill. But before we get there, let's go back to where we left Anne after the radio station. Back in the cage, DJ Ricks and Anne are trapped. But the monsters start to come for them, and DJ Ricks tells Anne, "Sometimes you just gotta change the tune, change the record. You can't keep going on like this." He thinks he can't change the rules. And that's just the way it is. He asks her if she has the guts, as his own guts are ripped out by the monsters. And they begin to fall down, and falling into water. Now, being down in the water, Anne starts to hear her dad telling her that she has one last thing to finish, that she needs to rise up from the water and do this one last thing. And she really thinks she's hearing her dad's voice, and she says, "Okay, Daddy, I'll do it." But the truth is, it's just the town goading her into killing Pendleton. And much in the comic book, this scene plays out just in the video game's cutscene. So let's go ahead and watch that, and we'll come back to the comic book and try to end this whole story as it is.
Think it could end like this?
After everything you saw back there, everything we've been through, you think going back to prison is all that's at stake here?
We're not going to Wayside.
What are you saying?
Turn the boat around.
Are you out of your mind? We're free. When we reach the opposite shore, I'll go one way, you can go the other. It's that easy.
We've got unfinished business, you and I.
I have no idea what the hell you're talking about, and honestly, I don't care anymore. There is no way in hell I'm going back.
It wasn't a request.
We've both just been through hell. Haven't you been paying attention?
No, you haven't been paying attention. You think this is all an accident, just a big coincidence? This town, it knows me. It showed me things. It wants me to finish this. Don't you understand? It'll never let us go until we finish what we started. What you started.
I told you. I'm not going back. You might as well shoot me.
Now, in the game, we don't see this, but in the comic book, lightning strikes the boat, and Anne falls back into the water, and she wakes back up inside of the prison, seeing her dad dying, and a monster looming over her, and then it would revert back into a video game cutscene, where she asks how Pendleton could do it, and again, all she sees is the monster, and this is where the comic book and the game kind of really mesh together. And there's not really a huge bit of difference other than what's going on inside of Anne's mind. And it's basically revenge. But in the video game, we would wake up as Pendleton, seeing the Wheelman and Silent Hill father outside of his cell, and Pendleton has to go through the prison and fight his way there until he gets to the end where he catches up with Anne. And this is after he defeats the giant Wheelman, the final boss of the game, pulling out these life support systems. This, again, meshes well with the game as the comic book, so there's a little jumping back and forth, but it's essentially the same thing. Anne gets into a fight with the Pendleton monster in the prison while all the monsters come out. Finally, Anne gets to see some of what Pendleton saw and lived through, and that's that Sua was actually the one that killed her dad, Coleridge. So she realizes she no longer needs to take revenge on Murphy, and Murphy quits fighting back because he doesn't want to kill her, and he doesn't want to be a monster. But that won't stop Anne from eventually wanting to take revenge on Sewell, which all of this plays out in the ending cutscene. I just want to thank everyone for watching this. I hope it was fun. There'll be more Silent Hill content to come, of course. Please like, follow, share, subscribe, all the things. I leave you with a little lullaby.
Words of love sent by you. Any way you get them through, words of love trouble me. Feels like someone's watching me. Loving hands around my throat, barbed wire speaking of, sounds like panic. Tie the strings and I play dead. All around me, speak about you. Always find me and remind me of you. Erased every line you wrote, words you stole, my quotes of love, paper bins over.